Hello, so this is the section policy scenario procurement study geospatial web. Cool concept. The M100 Visix headwear, augmented reality. So what do we need to make this work? What is a policy scenario that's going to make a new technology fit into an infrastructure? So this is one of the more complicated tasks in setting up a smart grid, smart city, and looking at the view of the forensics and criminology side of cybernetics. So let's look at a very focused approach to a model that we're going to use, the Berlin 3D, the 44,000 buildings that were uploaded to Google Earth. And we're going to approach building a new city in the geospatial framework for geospatial web, and appropriate a cost model and a business market study that will look at approaching architectural firms for standard 3D modeling. And in going into that, we're going to find a consumer market from the architectural 3D mapping technology and try to offset the expenses to create a good geospatial technology framework in order to build a kind of microcosm, if we can use that word, a microcosm for a cybernetic reality augmented technology geospatial framework. So we're going to build the infrastructure first and work through what is the difference between having an infrastructure for 3D augmented reality mobile computing. And then we're going to go through a lot of the scenario analysis from a controlled environment. Working from a control environment, we're going to look at threat analysis, having a full backdrop to the compatibility of the geospatial web in one hand and the M100 in another. So let's have some fun here, and let's work through some of the concepts as we approach some businesses on the expenses and the cost burden analysis and get some public opinion polling going. So we're going to talk to a few businesses about the type of expenses and the idea that they feel when they hear that Berlin has these 3D modeled cities, and what type of competitive sense of, wow, this is cool, you know, here's this city in Germany that has, you know, about 25-26% of its city in a 3D spatial template. So why is it a necessity? And that's what we're going to talk about as we look at an industry and an infrastructure shift towards the importance of 3D modeling and a geospatial web as we get closer to the M100 and the focus of this cybernetic investigation, which is path integration sciences. And we're going to go a little bit further with the path integration sciences into a very, very specific applied criminology use for forensic profiling as we basically take tour software. If you can imagine the Boston Freedom Trail, as we take a tour software that, in this traditional sense, the two-dimensional framework for using smartphones and mobile communication in tour software, but we're going to go through the augmented reality, we're going to work through path integration and a focused manpower approach to a developer corner, and as we go through that, it's kind of forward mapping you into the next subjects, because this is the most important criteria for an infrastructure to have a geospatial web. So we're going to look at each one of these independently in a critical examination. And as we go through the critical examination, different markets, market concepts, market focus groups from a think tank, and really break down exactly where the industry is at, exactly where this technology is at. But we're going to go at it from the criminology side. So by the time we're done with this, we'll have completed the Muhammad Atta walk with the Visix 100, M100, and we'll have constructed a geospatial temporal map, an analyzing signals intelligence, ELINT, COMINT, SIGINT, and we'll try to create a forensic reconstruction of the psychology of what was occurring. We'll also do this with James Holmes and the Eric Harris Columbine shooter. So as we go through this path integration science technology, we'll have some interesting findings. Thank you. Hello. So this is the section on path integration technology. Ooh, sounds cool. Policy scenario analysis part one, geospatial web. And now let's find the buy section where the big developer market's at for software code writing and in this specific cybernetic detective where the critical forensic criminology side is part of a discipline for software code writing. So using this M100, now we've approached the geospatial web, looked at it, given a little bit of a concept background, gone through the infrastructure sciences a little bit. We contrasted the Berlin 3D city, and we looked at how an infrastructure with 44,000 buildings in a three-dimensional space have their specific dynamics in a code writing software to where now we go into path integration sciences. Path integration, the science. First, let's go into the history where we can understand path integration from animal behavior, cognitive sciences, and we're going to look at briefly the MIT School of Cognitive Sciences and the definition here with path integration as we go further into the effects augmented reality technology and real-time mobile users in a geospatial framework are going to be able to impact their day-to-day lives. And as we look at different markets, the software framework in a very specific discipline of code writing. By now, it's probably convenient to understand what a path is from a GPS technology with accelerometers and other positioning data. As we go further into the evolution of the real-time feedback in a geospatial environment, from looking at a concept and the importance of the duality of a geospatial web on one side, which is a spatially corrected temporal or template that is temporally aligned to some type of a resolution threshold or vector resolution threshold, where we can say these corners are aligned here, these corners are aligned here, and we keep a certain attribute of calibration off of the data that we get so that we can try to create a distinction for how close our error deviance is up. Error deviance in that sense would be a kind of machinist term for tolerance. So we'd say plus or minus whatever the tolerance range is for calibrating XYZ against any two points in GPS data. But taking a geospatial framework and building an infrastructure to incentivize, to create an incentive compatibility between the device and a developer community. So having now the impetus to build a model city, we're going to go further into path integration sciences here, and we're going to look at specific markets that differentiate in different industries as we go at each one of the different industries, from marketing ad space path integration to infrastructure first responder technology, criminology. So as we go through these different market and job specific relations of where path integration technology is, we're going to start from the top down, from a top-down policy approach, be that a think tank and a policy scenario analysis from signals intelligence. So we're going to start with SIGINT, ELINT, COMINT, and MASINT, and we're going to go at it from a codebreaker perspective, and then all the other industries should align in some uniform procession towards security practices. And that concept, the underpinning is, when we look at infrastructure, we say, okay, well, Germany has done this with their modeled city, and here they are looking at cascade domino effect collapses because of utility sector or plumbing sector, and here's this 3D spatial web, and here's where they're using it in this capacity, and now we're going to walk through the augmented reality. Now I see, okay, here's the plumbing section, here's how this all broke down, here's the utility section, oops, now we see this infrastructure problem. So get used to the word infrastructure, because now that we're defining a smart city and in that smart grid framework, as we go further into the path integration here in this scenario. So now that we've established the geospatial web in one context, smart cities, what it means for infrastructure to advance their architecture and local sense of, let's say, modeling a city around cybernetics and controlled information feedback. Now we've gone into path integration sciences briefly. So now we're going to go into some of the more complicated questions of where does this lead us as a society as we go into M2M, router topology, which is mobile-to-mobile router topology, and swarm intelligence. For those of you who aren't familiar with swarm intelligence, much of the robotic technology that we've looked at in the future from an advanced analysis of competing robots, cellular automata, autonomous building robots, swarm intelligence is a concept that as we get more competing devices, competing for resources, evolutionary acquisition, resource-based consumption, looking at the behavior of a beehive or looking at the behavior in the context of a swarm, what does it mean to have a swarm? So we're going to look at a few really complicated router topologies for some common ELINT, SIGINT, and we're going to, within this smart city infrastructure, isolate a different security layer system for a group of users by M2M. Then we're going to allocate an input-output board, essentially. And from an input-output board, we're going to talk about mobile-to-mobile from some really cool concepts in competing industries. And we're going to go into some interesting market theories. One is a market derivative selling the VISIX 100 service of the path integration of a Hollywood star. And we're going to do some timeshare of cameras, timeshare of audio services, so visual and audio services of some very interesting people. We're going to try to promote the concept of VISIX from selling a service or marketing a commodity from a marketing approach, obviously. And then we're going to look at what is the concept of M2M sharing and router relays between input-output, and we're going to work from our path integration sciences. So in this scenario, we're going to go further into our last two, having the geospatial web, a smart city, having our path integration broken down by the importance of what it means to go along a path and have customizable geotags that are based on your own environmental parameters, and then regulated ones that are based on an infrastructure approach to regulation of a geospatial web, a more complicated approach from privatization to the regulatory framework that we might see with Google Earth 3D and the concept of Berlin 3D. So now as we go into swarm intelligence, we're going to take a model of a swarm, a group of, this is for the mass inside, since we're doing four different signals intelligence approaches, ELINT, SIGINT, COMINT, and the mass INT. So the mass INT, massive or mass surveillance, we have to approach a problem and say all of these have a minimum output, a minimum regulatory compliance. That minimum regulatory compliance starts at the beginning of the manufacturing process from the FCC, the Federal Communications Commission. These are things that are non-intrusive types of information. Non-intrusive types of information, location data in one context, where people allow the third-party reciprocal agreements, such as Facebook, to have access to your spatial data, and then that access goes to this consumer interest group, which shares data, so on and so forth. A lot of people don't understand that their consumer rights are automatically violated, and the Federal Trade Commission has already gone after Facebook at least a couple times in this concept of regulation of your geolocation data. From Google Earth and the policy rights provisions that you enable, you're enabling people to watch you. So keep that in mind, that this isn't so much so, well, why would I be concerned about that? Why do I want to give up my rights? Well, you've already given them up by using the device. Well, if you don't use a device and it's not a necessitation, well, then you shouldn't use it. Then use sticks and stones. In order to adapt to the modern curve of technology integrated in a day-to-day part of your life, there are advantages and disadvantages, pros and cons. Being on top of the pros and having your rights known in a competitive environment is the only way to keep your rights. This is something that is part of the learning curve towards technology in day-to-day life. In a technocracy, as we go a little bit further into this M2M router relay, we'll see that this is a very interesting way to look at mass intelligence. Hello, this is the interesting part that probably will end up selling the augmented reality technology. This is the social networking aspect. What exactly, now that we've covered a geospatial web, infrastructure approach, architectural designs being uploaded to a customized city, a smart city. We've worked from the smart city concept from business to business, creating a Wi-Fi framework for community, centered on obviously mobile computing and customized augmented reality. So now we've gone through that, path integration, the signals intelligence side of swarm intelligence, M2N topology routing, which there's other market focus groups in there. So now let's go into the fun one, the one that's going to sell it. Okay. Obviously we can say Facebook, but any intra-development or internal development side of a corporation that wants to control its hardware, wants to control its software, wants to make a market dominance and doesn't want to collateralize and say, well, the hardware itself has a certain technical patents controlling the industry, but as we saw with the smartphone, the reverse engineering of technology from iPhone having the cutting edge, breaking the industry open, what I guess the developer market really looking at what we know from obviously saying break the market open, control and dominate the curve of information, create a reliance on consumer trust, keep that consumer trust in the forefront of the market commodity and develop and keep that development. That means building your own social web and then mitigating the control for the technology hardware and keeping the best programmers, keeping the best software, keeping the best and most creative thinkers working in the industry who understand what it takes to make a major corporation work. Venture capital obviously will see these purveys and say, well, look at all these different companies out there trying to break in augmented reality, social networking. Okay, so why is it going to change the consumer side of simplifying a very complex and absolutely emergent field of communication technology? Walking around the street, seeing an augmented space where other users who have augmented reality plugged into their social networking, being able to instantly hyperlink through their associative paths, the pathology or hypertext link pathology in a real-time associative file mapping process. What exactly does this mean as an individual walking down the street? Obviously, wearing a heads-up display looks a little strange, but once I see the necessitation as a market consumer, once I identify that this is fun, this is a way to meet people, this is an approach that I've never seen before, this is a genuine market controlling factor for augmented reality, and it will probably change the immediate landscape of a lot of national security practices for how the information is already being used that we don't want to know about. And ultimately, what does that mean? Taking a two-dimensional landscape of GPS dots going around and linking to all their file mapping clusters and so on and so forth. So now let's take this into the consumer side and let's go through and let's work through a scenario with, obviously we're going to use Facebook, but we're going to work from a Visix Facebook, and we're going to say, walking through this path. These are the people's profiles. This is how fast I was able to see their GPS icon go to the Facebook, and here's a little heads up halo display that's over their head, and now I've accessed the web page and I've sent a friend request. Well, this is cool, you work in this, awesome, you're a designer, cool, I just had this phenomenal idea for this, and you work in machining, oh, that's wonderful, I was doing this, okay, well, obviously, as you go through it, we'll see that wherever there is a market, wherever there is something that gives people an advantage to look at problems, to communicate, to find new friends or to expand their networks, we'll see immediately the corporate raiders, market saboteurs, industrial threat assessments, and you know, people going around with this type of profile or this type of profile, hacked profiles. I mean, the entire thing, obviously, we'll see people with fake identities, front identities, back identities, every type of thing that you can possibly imagine, but still we'll identify that this is a real consumer curve and process as we go through it. So augmented reality, social networking, is it going to be the driver of creating the M100 market alignment with, obviously, mobile computing? And where we'll see the technology developers center. The technology developers centering in one field means manpower. In order to make an industry grow, any industry, every industry requires manpower, human resources. This is the market capital problem of every major corporation. But when we focus on the most important science, which is path integration technology, and we dominate that path integration technology, we will have the best software code writers to work through and to create an infrastructure in order to understand this. We have to do this from the signals intelligence side in order to control the framework of development. Okay, so now we've gone through some interesting evolutions to the last one, where spatial, temporal, epidemiological modeling, transport, vector analysis, disease spread by airlines carrying avian bird flu, went a little bit into some of the threats behind microbiology and diseases. So we kind of took it all the way back to Fort Detrick and disease epidemiology, all the way back to the 21st Signals Brigade. Now we're going to go through the back propagation and artificial neural networking walk and infrastructure analysis. So this concept in a threat analysis is a little bit different, but it still deals with ultimately path integration sciences. But now we're going to go a little bit further. This is where we take the very interesting process of understanding the human mind and starting to treat the human mind as a linear classifier. Machine learning technology and robotics vision will be the focus of how we look at the camera technology in the M100. So now we're going to apply software that we're going to essentially sequester. So we're going to go through a corporate model from Vuzix, and now we're going to mandate sequestration from a looking at IBM under a threat viewfinder. So as we look at IBM and we say, okay, what is it that IBM has that obviously from Watson supercomputer, from predictive computing, analytics, cognitive computing, supercomputing, cognitive computing, the spatial temporal epidemiological modeling. Here's a corporation that has become so big and so compartmentalized and so developmentally based on computer information sciences, that even its robotics division, just merely in the machine learning and the appropriation of an infrastructure premise, we're going to go and we're going to look at one specific context of the IBM Corporation in cognitive computing. So we're going to go that route, and then we're going to look at machine learning, the algorithms for robotics vision. Then we're going to apply those algorithms to the interpretation on the M100. So now we're going to talk about software, hardware development in advancing a technology for the augmented reality, cybernetics, onboard computing. Now, with that onboard computing, we're going to look at the offboard geospatial intelligence web, and we're going to contrast the importance of infrastructure analysis and the backpropagation A.n.n walk is what we'll call it. Okay, so in this, we're going to take a straight line, a GPS path. We're going to walk through a city landscape with the geospatial 3D Berlin web. And as we go by a building, what we're going to do is interpret the building by the fundamental minimum standard requirements of a smart city, i.e. telecommunication, i.e. water supply, i.e. utility grid, and there's a few other fundamental premises, but in this overlay for augmented reality, for all intents and purposes, reaching a critical fundamental reference of necessity, now we're going to look at artificial neural networking as we go through this single line, and we're going to create a feedback circulatory loop of information based on the machine learning, cognitive computing side of the M100, and we're going to essentially purport that what we're recording is really for an upload to a high-level supercomputer for analysis at a later time. Our mind, our senses, aren't going to record all the information, so this will be a service industry based on synthetic interpretation. Now, what does that mean? Can anyone be a information collector? As an individual walking through a point in time-space, I have just now done this, so you just acquired the video footage of my eyes for today, and it is worth n sum of dollars. Well, in that concept, obviously, you couldn't pay an entire society a certain per diem or percentage to obviously upload all that information and assemble it into a supercomputer in order to take that supercomputer information and rank the environment the way robotics vision would interpret its environment. But as we get more of these intuitive software developments that take man-human-computer interfacing, path integration, A.n.n. So in this A.n.n walk, what we're going to do is we're going to take a specific model of a parts manifest. This parts manifest is called Section P. So keeping with this, I'll show you Section P here. So this is the real innovative side of artificial neural networking and backpropagation for augmented reality and custom memory and essentially creating your own memory feedback. So we're going to take our own library, our own synthetic memory. We're going to assume that our memory that records in our brain in neural networking, and we're going to try to contrast the memory that is synthetic against the memory that is real. So as we have this duality of the constant recording with our M100, a synthetic memory database, and we're going to go through this walk and look at a very specific path integration feedback function. So this is going to be fun, and I think that this is the meat of the software. This is the meat of the most interesting part of this augmented reality cybernetic detective. So I hope that you guys have fun thinking about this, because I know that I do. Okay, so now we've gone from a geospatial web, we've taken it to the M100 and path integration sciences, developer market from signals intelligence, ELINT, COMINT, SIGINT, MASINT. We've applied it in one specific counterterrorism case. We've looked at transportation analysis, traffic analysis, and we've taken it now towards backpropagation epochs, which is essentially the last section, which we discussed as path integration and artificial neural networking and infrastructure analysis. So now we're going to go into parts from Section P. Now we're going a little bit out of the norm of any type of industry that we'll probably see. So customizing an A.n.n through backpropagation epochs, defining. This is a defining cybernetic principle. So, this parts manifest, which I'm going to show you here, is the wheel of progress. For those of us who know the philosophical concept of the wheel of progress, Looking at cybernetics as a circularity of reasoning, a system of systems, cyclic feedback with some type of calibration, and a calibration process with back propagation, hidden networks, and a whole sort of different concepts, we have to really simplify how we want to interpret all the mobile devices. First of all, just like Mammoth Hill being called a ground node segment for a signals intelligence listening station, what we're going to refer to every cybernetic augmented reality device, every M100, as a node. Now, in order to understand node sciences, we now have to take a space as asymmetrically bounded, meaning upper and lower bounding. So whenever we find two things that are bound together, we want to associate how distinct they are based on treating a node. Okay, so now we're going to take section P. Section P is part of a proposal for a business. Section P is a bunch of parts, and each one of these parts is required to build a wheel. This wheel is a symbol of the wheel of progress. Now we're going to assign a custom artificial neural networking value so that when we walk through an infrastructure, we can have any place where there is a part that has a relevance of an association towards that wheel, that it is going to be fed back to us, and we're going to assign our own values now. So we're taking a viable system model, which is a principle in cybernetics. We're going to take this VSM model. Now we're going to do variable interpolation. So we're going to take an MU system. Now, for those of you who understand Douglas Hofstadler's look into MU systems, we're going to take this MU system and we're going to say, we want to find isomorphs. Whoa, how cool to use augmented reality to look at your own memory substrate, reference against a synthetic memory substrate, which is obviously the electromagnetic media that has been encoded with the data, and then to say, this is how a neural network operates, this is how information is stored in this constellation, this substrate, this memory system that our eyes and our ears record. Now we're going to take a feedback loop, and we're going to assign our own memory calibration. What does that mean? It means freaking awesome is what it means. It means that's too cool. We are going to be able to change our environment based on custom viable system models in order to feedback a control loop of our own memory against our own environment, bridging the gap between environment influencing our behavior as we close a loop of our own reflexivity. This is a movement. Cybernetics and augmented reality, being able to change a synaptic frequency of your own memory against a synthetic memory and have control over it. In this, the concept that we're working on is recurrent neural networking. Recurrent neural networking, as we look at it from symbolism, now if we take the literal definition of symbolism, and we go to MIT Cognitive Sciences and we say, here's the definition of symbolism, here's where we get to recurrent neural networking, and here is the principle of a circularity of reasoning, a recurrent principle, and here's this archetype of a wheel structure, and here's this wheel of progress. Now we've taken it to the literal science boundary of what it takes to build, machine, the entire process, down to the finite screws, the pitch, the thread, the machine engineering side of each one of these parts. And now we're saying, this object relation map of a function, and this function is how we build it, and what is this function for, so on and so forth. So we're going to take a very literal mechanical engineering diagram, a very literal construction, all the necessary machining processi, and we're going to take all that machining, all that mechanical engineering, all those principles, and we're going to apply a viable system model, and we're going to create a feedback from a viable system model of an actual archetype, of an actual architectural system. Now we're going to apply that on a walk to create our own feedback against the environment. And we'll see how well this works. Should be fun. So now we've gone through The infrastructure part of a geospatial web, path integration sciences, a specific counterterrorism aspect of ELINT with one specific case. Now we've moved it across the landscape of customizing artificial neural networkings, So what is it that the will of progress and this interaction between synthetic memory and real memory? What is synthetic memory? Well, as we bring this cybernetics movement, the recorded audio and visual system of having it uploaded every single day or recording our the information that we've collected in a day by our devices as one type of sense, taking each device as a node and taking each device as a node of senses. The individual has this many senses, and now with this added feature has this many senses with this added sense and processing. Taking the IBM cognitive computing side, machine learning, linear classification algorithms, and computationally taking sight and sound and geospatial data. From this path integration science, now we're going to look at synthetic memory, and we're going to start this section P, this will of progress, and custom feedback, the fun part here. This is the exciting part. Artificial neural networking and learning to develop a way to change the signal weight. Now, in artificial neural networking, if you're going to change a bias of a signal weight inside a neural network, in this concept, we're going to take our path, we're going to take our augmented reality headset, our M100, and we're going to walk through a spatial map. We're going to walk through one with an infrastructure, the Berlin city map. We're going to take the information that's architectural from a viable system model, ranking that against the geotags, taking those geotags and assigning a variable interdependent feedback from our parts manifest, whereas where there are screws this, where there are these bushings this, where there are these so on and so forth. So we're going to take this fundamental will of progress and weather is aluminum. So in this concept of itemizing a taxonomy list, looking at this in a heuristic or a cladistic model, we're going to take this as a cladistic function. So this cladistic model and creating a variable feedback from a viable system model. So we're going to say this is the M system, this is the U system. We're going to find the isomorphs. And in those isomorphs, we're going to adjust the weights that we get as a feedback on our own custom artificial neural network. Now, this may sound fairly interesting, but what does it mean? It means neurocybernetics is what it means. It is very simple. It means that we are now taking human-computer interfacing, we are now customizing feedback from our own memory, long-term, short-term, hippocampal research that we would see with, Dr. Alvarez and Dr. Squire. We would look at their long-term memory, retrograde amnesia. We would look at the studies in connectionism, symbolism, something that's a symbol like the wheel of progress. And we're going to take a symbol map, and essentially, as we take this long-term, short-term memory and our attention memory, and we're going to take our attention memory and we're going to essentially indoctrinate our own feedback from our attention memory. And that is going to be part of building our own A.n.n. So we're going to change the way we store information in our brain by using a synthetic device and synthetic memory. So this will become part of neurocybernetics. For those of you who don't understand the interesting part of this, is that building a feedback control to motor neurons from Pavlovian trace conditioning and taking an input over time and then developing the bridging, the synaptic bridging of short-term, long-term memory. Memory disruption, memory disturbance, bombarding the human mind with different signals. The media side, the corporations, the government guilt machines of foreign governments, the building of a new religion after the Frank Church Committee, the kind of movement towards a building some type of control that you have with your own memories against any type of other external control. So we're going to talk about something called synthetic memory and the memex man. And I've got a kind of fun aspect to go into this. It's a short story called The Memex Men. And we're going to look at the science fiction side of what is the Vannevar-Bush Raytheon Memex machine? What is this hyperlinking system that he's talking about in the 40s and 50s? And we're going to look at this memory, the synthetic memory, in the same type of context as we go into this futurist scenario. We go into the kind of sci-fi, Philip K. Dick-esque mindset. We're gonna break away from all of this scenario, all of this policy, all of this, into looking at what the importance is of synthetic memory, as we have so many recording devices constantly making an assemblage of information. And now putting that into cybernetics, putting that into a smart grid, putting that into a node system of cataloging information. And now from synthetic memory, we're going to go a little bit further, and we're going to really get to the brunt of neurocybernetics and look at how this is the beginning of human-computer interfacing, how exciting it is to be able to go and break open this, this system of adjusting signal weights. So the focus of this part is, what is artificial neural networking? How do we use back propagation epochs to adjust signal weights? And that's the most important part. That's the simplified aspect of what we're going to do with this next path integration. So now that we've gone through, obviously, there's going to be a movement here in the next year, year and a half, with smartwatches, software for smartwatches, wristbands that monitor a slew of different type of information. The health industries are starting to advance to this human-computer interfacing, and even as far back as 10, 11 years ago, I think toothbrushes that check and monitor your health and vital signs while you brush your teeth. The industry of human-computer interfacing, cybernetics, going from having an infrastructure to work within this M100 framework to following our path integration sciences, then a specific investigation, working from that specific investigation, the ELINT, COMET, SIGINT, MassINT, going further into customizing backpropagation, artificial neural networking, and adjusting bias weights and skewing bias weights so that we can appropriate a certain association with synthetic memory versus real memory. There's a couple topics here that can be expounded upon, and probably more in the philosophical sense of basically bonding, pairwise coupling, or twinning is one of the concepts of serial or parallel computing, and then taking this node space and say, well, all these different electronic components are part of one huge, massive cluster of information. How do we rank all the information, sort threats out, and put this clustered node of this infrastructure and all these devices moving around to interpret what a threat is? Is a threat a human thought? Is a threat when someone's heartbeat elevates? Is a threat when someone gets an erection or is stimulated in a certain way? Presumably, the interfacing industry will have its own focus on those types of technologies. And we're going to go a little bit into neurocybernetics here as we look at synaptic spiking gates, memory trace routes, and galvanic pressure response from a chemical interrogation premise of human-computer interfacing. How is human-computer interfacing an interrogative tool? How is cybernetics an interrogative tool? How do we take information that we can see with our eyes, and now that we can look through this and perceive it with the M100, looking through the M100 and seeing these images, and how do we say, this synthetic memory over the course of a year, for anyone who goes through, let's say, the M100 synthetic memory program, building a memory database that is uploaded every single night over the course of the year to create a kind of model of synthetic memory for ranking and sorting algorithms and machine learning to catalog all that information and say, this is the statistical information that my supercomputer that was tasked to look at all this information of 10,000, 20,000 people, or 200, or 5, or however many. The point of the matter is, ultimately, once we take a look at customizing and changing the synaptic weights between the input and the output of our senses that we don't have control over in our environment, and then adjusting them to what we can have control over. And that type of control that we can have, as far as memory-based, a trigger, we'd say memory traces, engrams, a memory engram in a neural network, and say, well, I just triggered this memory because of this input-output, this. So now we're obviously going to get a curve on the memory that we're building, because now we're building new memories. New memories with synthetic, new memories with a type of cybernetic device will obviously have a curve on the impact that memory consolidation will have over the course of a year. So we might see that this neurocybernetics movement, after a year, after 2 years, that people get tired of wearing these devices, but they don't get tired of recording their constant interactions or constantly having their own recorded truth or their own defense. Because recording your environment is defense in the procession of the human survival instinct, and in the procession of a society that's constantly being disarmed. Records and constant recording is a defense. I think that this is something that is probably highly regarded in the sense of a violation of privacy, but also not just a violation of privacy, but the impact that it'll have on how we look at resource-based acquisition of individuals, the acquisition process, the human behavior process, having an extra pair of eyes, looking outward on what we do. And as we talk briefly about the M2M sale of eyes or eye sharing, we'll probably see Facebook eye sharing as a market commodity for user groups saying, hey man, what are you doing? Where are you going today? Well, I'm going out to this concert. All right, can I share your eyes? Yeah, hell yeah, all of you can. 20 of you, 30 of you, I don't care. And this is the type of impact that it'll also have on media. When people can't go into a building because they have the M100 on, what is that type of prejudice if it's become an interdependent process on you as an individual? If it's become an interdependent process on you as protecting your own memories or assimilating your own environment or building your own environment. In this concept, we're going to go into neurocybernetics, and we're going to look at some very interesting concepts. This is kind of a vague topic here, but we'll narrow it down and get to the actual memory engram trace route, and we'll start to show how adjusting signal weights in the memory and using it as an interrogation device over a period of time, where if you were hacked or where if information was coming into you from your sight and your auditory channel in the M100, that we can see an effect on human behavior over a longer period of time. So we're going to go look at that. Okay, the excitement continues. We've gone through infrastructures, geospatial web. We've gone through the evolution of path integration sciences, the transformation we'll see with augmented reality, and customizing artificial neural networking space, meaning custom back propagation through augmented reality using synthetic memory and our own memory as a kind of process for calibrating, adjusting signal weights. Now let's take that adjustment of signal weights and go all the nth way. Now, for those of you who understood that, all the nth way, the iterated set. Now, let's break this down. Let's go. We have the fundamental principles for artificial neural networking. We have the fundamental principles. So now let's calculate in front of us with predictive computing the nodes in a path, the tags in a path, and let's calculate the feed-forward neural networking principle as we look at calibrating predictive analytical. So we have X amount of predictions in a path now. Since we know the path, we know the event. So now that we know an event, now that we know a path, we can start to include something for our path integration in neurocybernetics. Now, adding neurocybernetics into this next layer will give us the ability to adjust signal weights based on predictive input of timing synapses so that we can take one course of a dialogue of input from sight and sound that is adjustable, and we can adjust that across the path of feedback. So now we can jump a different synthetic memory of associations that relate directly to common coding between the visual and the auditory system to create a reactive, responsive, Pavlovian condition. So now we're going to use a sense line. We're going to say on this line, this is the way the human body interprets the input. This is the stimulus response. And so we are going to go through something that we are going to call running tandems. Sounds fun. Two people now. So in neurocybernetics, what we're going to do is we're going to equip me here with a stimulator. We'll just call it stimulator device. We're going to equip this person over here, this female, with stimulator device. And we're going to share each other's eyes, but one is going to calculate my path, and I'm going to calculate her path. Now we're going to compete path integrations. So this is a competitive path integration. This is kind of a game we're going to play with path integration sciences. Where she goes in her path, I'm going to associate an input function on her nervous system by pressing this button. Wherever she goes in this path, if I can keep her thoughts going in this direction by pushing this button, and I can only push it 10 times in this path, we're going to develop a neurocybernetic response system. Now, in order for this to make sense, the conditioning of any nervous system, any neural network, has to have an increment and a decrement threshold. So as we get into the law of comparative judgment, and as we get into the concept of Weber's law, where we take a constant logarithmic difference, we're going to take that constant logarithmic difference and we're going to build ourselves a path of inductive feedback. We want that feedback, when we push this button, to create a response system based on our feed-forward neural network analysis of the path. At this point, turn here, look here, think A, sound A, look B, sound A, look B, sound A, look B. Now, once we get to this conditioning, we're going to be able to get this other person over a long enough period of time of training to turn with sound. Now, how far does that go into the nervous system? How far does that go into the neural networks? Well, with augmented reality and neurocybernetics, considering there's no such thing, I guess we don't have really a baseline to assume this by. But we will find out how to do this and prove it. Why did you turn your head there? I just motor neuron functionalized you to turn in anticipation of a pleasure, of a response, and now instead of this type of conditioning framework, let's change the conditioning framework and let's add reward systems. So now reward systems along a path. So anyway, neurocybernetics, as we go further into this next analysis where we're going to make another market, which is sense share, where we actually eye share each other's visual and auditory fields and create a stimulus response for the other person, which is an interesting market in and of itself, probably will be mitigated over to pleasure industries and probably be some money made on it, but I don't imagine be much more than some weird kinky thing, but that's not really why we're looking at it. We're looking at conditioning an actual nervous system, an artificial neural network, based on adjustments of weights, feedback control, and a principle in that feedback control that is based on interacting sight and sound to create a nervous system response on a reward scheme based on a neural network analysis of the forward path. So now we have a hypothetical path, we have a known path. Anytime there is a known path, now this should be very interesting for everyone to understand. In your life, when you type something in the internet, in your life, when you place where you're going, what you're doing, what you're thinking, Google now knows your path. And by this technology, by this idea, if there was a way to influence your thoughts, your sight, or your sound in any way, shape, or form over a long enough period of time, they would be able to influence you. Influence your behavior, influence your decisions, influence everything you do in your life, because they know where you're going, and that path, that integration path, that function of where you're going, the input into your brain, the thing you will see, the thing you will hear, those are the types of ideas that neurocybernetics is going to bring about with feed-forward neural networking and path integration. So anyway, we're going to get into this a little bit further as we go through the scenario and use the M100 and look at it in that context.